It's time for 28mm World War II action. Will you recreate history or reshape it your way? On the Bolt Action Hub at beastsofwar.com. Humanity has been driven from Earth, but now it's time to take it back. Join the Reconquest and fight the Scourge on the Drop Zone Commander Hub at beastsofwar.com.
Hey everyone, it's the end of another week in wargaming and in tabletop gaming in general. It's time for the Weekender.
It certainly is, Brother Lloyd.
No, we're like twins. We're gonna like check shirts and
yeah,
all today.
We're all checked up. We're like the bushwhackers.
His baldness today.
Yes. Justin is away and he has left me in charge of his console. So I have all these keyboards and mice and machines to operate. I get to operate Ben's head, make him big or small. I get to do all this stuff. So if today's show is utter crap, that's because I'm running it.
This should be the smoothest show we've ever done.
I highly doubt that. Shall we announce some prize winners?
Yes.
Yeah? Okay, so as you know, for the last few weeks, we've been running some prizes. Here are the winners. For the ProDOS goodies, who got the Predator Youngbloods, the Facehuggers, the Sentry guns from Alien vs. Predator, the winner of that was I Got Skills on Beasts of War. Uh-huh. The competition winners for the Warmachine EU Masters, which yourself and Justin are going to be talking about next week a little bit more.
Yep.
But we had a whole bunch of winners from that. These three winners each get a Battlegroup box of their choice from the Mark III release. And that's Dougie Monster, Ben Epp, and Nuke Mechanic. Congratulations,
well done,
guys. Then we have the big competition winner from last week. And this is the person who wins a copy of This War of Mine.
Yeah.
A custom sculpted character.
Yeah.
Based on them. And it'll be pro-painted, and you'll get your own stat card.
Yep.
And the winner of that on Beast of War.
Here we go.
Drum roll.
Warhound 67.
Yeah!
I wanted that prize. That's how cool that prize was. I was thinking, Warzan won that prize. Anyway, we also had three Steam codes to give away for This War of Mine on PC. Beast of War member Cabal Trainee won one. On Facebook, Brian Smith won another. I'm sure there's a lot of Brian Smiths out there. So, yeah, we know which one you are. And then finally on YouTube, PJ Van Geest. You sound like an assassin, man. I think that's an awesome
PJ
name.
PJ Van Geest.
PJ Van Geest.
That's interesting. It's kind of cool, actually.
Yeah, so you guys all get Steam keys.
Awesome.
Fantastic. That's your lot. We do have a prize on tomorrow's XLBS show.
Yep.
We'll be coming to that later on. Ben knows all the details. I know bugger all about it.
Yeah. Stay tuned to the end of the show. We're being cruel to you. You have to watch the end to find out.
Or use that magical bar that you just flip to the end of the show.
Shh, watch the whole thing. Before we get stuck into the news, Ben.
Yes.
There's an article that's popped up on the site and you want to bring it to our attention because you think it's really cool.
Yeah, so this community member, Bloodbeard, works at a school, and he's been trying to come up with some really interesting ways in order to get kids involved in cooperation, teamwork, and enjoying sort of like sci-fi and exploration and sort of space and things, right?
Yeah.
So he put together this really cool game where all the kids join together in teams and they go out and explore this amazingly well laid out board, which is covered in planets to explore, asteroids, all sorts of different things.
I'm giggling because Warren's controlling the desk and he's already screwed up.
I'm controlling the desk. I'm already buggered up. But that's okay. Look, just keep going. I was trying to play the video so that you could see a bit of it, while it was running. But yeah, okay. Right. So keep talking, Ben. I'm now scrolling.
But yeah, so he sat down and created this huge board, which is 120 centimeters by 200 centimeters. Absolutely massive. And it's got 936 tiles on it that all have different things on. Like I said, there's planets and space lanes and debris.
I think I have a picture of the board if you slow down.
Yeah.
There.
Yeah.
And what is the dimensions of the board?
120 centimeters by 200 centimeters.
In wargaming terms, what's that?
How many eight
no
by
idea.
Four?
8x4.
But yeah, so the whole idea about this is that the kids join together as teams and they go out with their colony ships.
Yeah.
That were actually supplied by Spartan Games.
Work, Spartan. Yeah.
Yeah. So they went out with these ships and they go and found civilizations, discover alien species, a bit like Star Trek or and things like that. And then they have to work together to build their own home worlds and sort of exist together in this massive, huge galaxy that this guy's put together. And it seems really, really fun. Yeah. He said that there's a load of kids really involved with it at the school that he works at. And he's really excited for it. And they seem fascinated by it when they come by at lunchtime and things like that.
So
yeah, if you want to go and learn some more about this, go and check out the article. Yeah.
So it's not just about fighting and stuff like that and kicking shades out of each other. This is about setting up colonies, exploring, expanding.
Yes.
Is there any fighting in it?
There can be fighting in it, I think, but I'm not sure whether or not the kids have got to that point yet, no. But I'm sure they can blast some aliens as well if they want to, yeah.
Now, this category of game is called, what do we call this? This is like a mega game, isn't it?
It is effectively a mega game, yeah.
Now, the mega games are getting more and more kind of popular these days. You know, they were always kind of popular, right? Because you always kind of got clubs and stuff that got together and had kind of big campaign weekends, or they made up their own rules and stuff like that. But, you know, it is a type of game that I think is really worth exploring with a group of friends.
Yeah, I think so, for sure. It's one of those things that I think promotes some really fascinating and interesting ideas in terms of how you use games and stuff like that. The whole term behind this that I think is really important is the word gamification, which is something that's come up a lot in workplaces and schools, in where you use games and reward systems in order to promote learning and stuff like that. He did an older project, which is really cool, and you can learn a bit more about it in the forums themselves, called Roman Risk, where he taught them all about Roman expansion using his own version of Risk and stuff like that. So it's really cool. Yeah.
Well, I'll tell you what. I'm going to set you guys a challenge.
Oh.
Challenge,
huh?
Either in this week's XLBS or next week's XLBS or the week after. But in the next couple of XLBS, right?
Yeah.
Let's the three of us come up with three ideas for a mega game. Yeah?
Okay.
And we'll pitch them out and discuss them and see what's cool. All right.
Sounds good.
Yeah. So maybe not this week,
but maybe this week.
But maybe this week, but maybe next week, right? And we'll see if we can come up with a mega game.
Awesome.
But I think it's fantastic what Bloodbeard's doing on the site. You know, just the whole utilizing gaming as a means of education, as a means of trying to teach some lessons and get these things across, and it'll be interesting because you know one of our topics over the course of the weekend is looking at the life lessons that you learn even from D&D. There was a great TED talk. I think we're going to talk about it on tomorrow's XLBS show.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
Yep. We are indeed. Right. Before we get too distracted with what's on tomorrow, let's concentrate on today.
Yes.
News, Ben. We're going to move on with the news. What's up first for us, mate?
Cool. So the first thing is something from the guys at Tor Gaming. They've been developing the Ridend faction for Relics, and they showed off a really cool exclusive for us, which was this Duke model, who's atop one of the Capalop birds, and he looks really cool. He's the first mounted character for these guys you can help ride with the knights into battle.
So. This is cool.
One of the things I love about the Ridend in Relics. Yeah. Now, if you guys have been watching, on Friday night we put out the first of a little series of shows that we're going to be doing. Exploring and following along as Relics puts their next edition through all its beta testing. So it's an opportunity for us. We were talking with them and we thought, do you know what? It might be kind of cool to follow along with the beta testing thing, try and get involved ourselves as well, and just explore the whole thing of beta testing and see what we can find out about testing games and about being involved. And of course, if you guys are interested in getting involved, go and watch the show. They give you a bit of a breakdown. All the rules are free. All the army lists are free. And they even put together some bundles for Beast of War members, where if you did want to pick up a few models to try, bearing in mind, in a beta, feel free to proxy, use bits of card or empty bases, whatever you want. But if you wanted to pick up a few models, They did four, I think it was four, really nice bundles with a fairly hefty discount on them, or bundles of models with a fairly hefty discount on them. So if you wanted to get involved to that extent, you absolutely could.
It's cool to see it going into the beta and the new rules and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Because I'm kind of interested in getting a little foothold in the game, because there's two factions that particularly appeal to me.
Yeah.
And this is one of them.
The beauty of these, right, is that these are goblins,
yes,
right? But not goblins like you or I have ever experienced them. These are chivalrous goblins. So these are goblins with honor who like to wear shiny armor and ride on giant cocks. It's incredible. They even have a huge cock with a big tower on its back, right?
Right.
And there's a goblin standing on the tower, and it's like a siege tower.
We might
tower
be able to see
thing.
That because I think we have another link.
Oh well, let me see. So here, this is the one.
There it is.
There we go. What do you see? This. Have a look at that.
This is very cool.
Isn't it awesome? Now I suppose that's. I'm not sure if that's a cock. It might be more of a griffin kind of a thing. But anyway, they're big meaty birds. So they are. So it's yeah.
Let's go back to the new release.
Mm-hmm.
The thing I liked about this, now we've talked about this on the show before, Ben, haven't we?
Yeah, yeah.
And what I like is there's a particular in Labyrinth, right? Do you know the goblins in Labyrinth?
Yes.
They're in the suits of armor and stuff. And I've always wanted that.
This is them.
But describe the way you've described them. It's them crossed over with the little dog.
Yes.
Who's all chivalrous.
Effectively, yeah.
It is fabulous, you know, and it's such a fun, quirky little game, you know. I'm just really looking forward to try and get into the meats and bones of it. I think you might enjoy Relics as well, though, because one of the great game mechanics of Relics, right, is it's all based around rolling doubles.
Yeah.
Okay? So it doesn't matter if you're one of these people that always rolls once. So long as you roll lots of ones, you're going to be fine. You know? So it's a really satisfying thing. I was saying last night in the beta show, whenever I played it for the first time, oh, a good while back, it was such a satisfying feeling, you know, rolling the doubles and stuff like that. And it was easy to pick out what was a success and what wasn't a success. And you know, it's nice when you can come up with a mechanic where there's something psychologically satisfying just about the mechanic, regardless of the score. There is just something satisfying about it.
Well, I'm liking this. The hobbyist in me was zeroing on this faction.
Yeah.
And I like is it the Bretonians?
Yes, the puppets.
I think Tor's missing a bit of a trick there, though, because I think the puppets should break out of just being the Bretonians and into like a French version of the Bretonians and things like that. I think I wouldn't mind a couple of little puppets.
Do you just want like Napoleonic puppets?
Yes, I want basically Napoleonic puppets. Which I think would be really cool. My French ones v your Brit ones.
Yeah,
cool.
Well, I can give you a very quick idea of what the Britannians look like. So this is your Britannians.
Yeah.
And you can see all the little puppets. Like, look at these guys here, the Rangers. You know.
They are very cool.
Aren't they just awesome?
Yeah.
You know, it's, let me just go back one to you, see some of them painted. Check these guys out. These are just your standard Britannian troopers.
Yeah.
And they're just lovely. There's just something really funky about it. Now, while I say it's lovely, remember, this is a dystopian world. So there are no good guys. These little buggers will cut you in half. You know, it's like, all of them, including the little chivalrous goblins on the giant cocks. They will just come up and they will just slice you in two. So it's it is brutal. It is brutal. Right, next up, right, we have Troglodytes and Tank Bears to have a look at.
Ooh.
Yeah, so this is some really cool new stuff from Historical Games for their awesome, strange, and interesting World War version of events in fantasy called Panzerfaust. And some of their new models that they've been showing off in render form are the Battle Moles, which are like the Kret Ulani, they're called.
Battle Moles! I love it!
Very awesome.
They're horrible and wrinkly.
Yes.
Exactly. They're like the horrible moles. Yeah.
They're like a pug with no hair.
I think it'd be great. I want to do these in a nice big fleshy pink. You know, just lovely. give them a dark wash, and they'll just look all horrible and wobbly, and it'll be brilliant. I just think they're great.
Is there another view?
Yeah, there's another view from the other side. Just look at them.
Oh, they've got like horns.
Yes. Well, any good mole would. You know.
Yeah, they're a really interesting and strange-looking mount, which I think is something that is fascinating about what historical games have been doing. And they've just been going completely off the wall with a lot of their fantasy stuff and choosing strange mounts for things. Like the halflings, or I think they're the gnomes, actually, have snails that they ride around on, which is pretty cool.
So, yeah.
We're also looking at a big bear, Ben.
Yeah, so this is the big Panzerbar, for the Germans. Well, not the Germans, the dwarves that have a German theme to them, and they've got a really awesome looking new tank, which is fantastic. Yeah, like
just how cool is that?
And a huge tank on top of it.
Yo, I've got to say, right, of all the animals, the bear is the scariest to me. Right. Especially
more so than crocodiles.
More so than crocodiles.
More so than mammoths.
More so than mammoths. You know, to me, the bear is the scariest of all the animals. I had a nightmare once, right, where I was being attacked by a polar bear. Right.
Yeah.
And the polar bear was on an iceberg, floating along the coast. Right.
Yeah.
Now this coastline was in a place called Port Rush, which is basically like a, I don't want to be too harsh on the place, but it's like a really grubby little seaside town. it's nothing special.
It's a tiny Blackpool.
Yeah, it's like a tiny version of Blackpool.
Tiny Blackpool. Okay.
So it's a real fish and chip den, right? So anyway, I was walking along the coast, and I could see this polar bear floating on an ice cube, like a big glacier mint bear, right? And he's floating along, and I have my son Manny. He tote, right?
Yeah.
And we have a tent up on top of the hill. And I'm looking at this bear going, this is really bad news, right? And this bear looks really mad, really angry, really hungry. But anyway, the bear lunges and runs up the beach and lunges over the seawall, right?
Okay.
And I shout to Manny to run, and to run and go and hide with his mum and stuff. And meanwhile, I'm standing there trying to get the bear to come after me, and then he sets off after Manny, and then I go mad and go after the bear to try and get the bear to come after me, and it was utterly terrifying. I woke up in such a cold sweat. Bears are terrifying.
Because but polar bears drink Diet Coke and Coke. What's scary about them?
I am telling you, polar bears to me are the scariest of all the bears, and bears are the scariest of all the animals.
Well, we know this because wasn't there a show that said who wins between bears and lions and all that sort of stuff, and the bear was always coming out on top, wasn't it?
I reckon you could put a polar bear up against anything, including a hippo, and the polar bear would win. Hippos are dangerous, but I'm not scared of hippos. I've seen the hungry hippo thing going. You know, I'm scared of bears. Bears are a terrifying thing.
You've been watching too many documentaries about that guy who used to live with bears.
Yes, yeah. That was horrendous. That was horrendous. But anyway, yeah, there we go.
Going back to this, Ben.
Yes.
We're looking at the bear and stuff here. Now, we've covered the releases a few times on the show. Can you tell us more about the actual game in so much as how do we get, if anybody's interested, how do we get rules and stuff for it?
Yeah, so there are a couple of rule sets that you can go and pick up for this to try it out with some of the models that they've already got out there. So up on Wargame Vault, you can get the skirmish rules, which are sort of a handful of models, or you can get the mass battle rules as well for in case you want to be trying out some of the big ones and stuff like that.
So it's two sets of rules.
So there's a skirmish set and a mass battle set then, Ben, yeah?
Yes.
And they're currently up in a beta form where you can just pay what you like for them, yeah?
Pretty much, yes, at the moment, yeah. So they're going to be developing over time, but obviously the more the community gets involved and plays the game and tries things out with the mechanics and stuff like that, they can expand on things, develop stuff as the project goes on, yeah.
Awesome, cool. So it is still in beta then, this game?
It's all still in the very early stage, yeah.
Awesome. Right.
What's next?
Cool, so the next thing up is, there's a bear in here, so you might want to turn away.
Here we go, again, yeah.
It's new stuff from the Guild Ball guys, and this is the Hunter's Guild, so they're expanding on this with a couple of new characters. They have Chaska, who's like their mountain man, their Davy Crockett.
That is Davy Crockett, isn't it?
Pretty much, yeah.
What is that he's got in his head?
I don't know. Let's have a look.
Is it a badger? It looks like a badger.
Yes. It is a badger.
You can see it's painted it in.
Well, do you know, if you were going to wear anything on your head, I think a badger, a well-made badger is going to be as good as any. I've got another story for you, right?
Okay, good.
It's about hats, right? It's about hats. So.
Do tell.
Right. I was in the museum, okay? And in the museum, they had this display and there was hats. And it was in the display all about rare earth kind of minerals and things like that there,
yes.
Right? And they used to put mercury into...
You sure it was mercury in the hats?
Yeah, no, yeah. What they had is they used to put mercury. I might have buggered all this up, but anyway, I'll tell you a story anyway my way, and it might be good. So this may be true. So it's like they used to put mercury into all sorts of stuff,
yes.
Right? Especially into medicines. Mercury was a good cure for syphilis and things like that.
Well, it wasn't a good cure, but it was what they thought would cure it.
Yeah. Anyway,
possible cure.
The thing about it is that. Hats were made by hatters and tanner hatters and stuff.
Oh,
like
I know
that,
where
right?
this story's going.
So, and what they used to do to try and treat the material that they made the hats from was they pissed on it, right?
Oh, right. I didn't expect it to go there, but okay.
So they would happily stand and whiz on the hats and stuff like that there to try and help tease out the properties of the material or whatever that they were making the hat from. But this one particular hat maker, right, he must have had a problem with his staff, particularly needing to use this mercury, right?
Right.
Because when they peed on it, right, they also peed this amount of mercury that was in their systems onto the hat.
Okay.
And they ended up making the finest hats of all the hat makers. His hats were fabulous compared to everybody else's because of the nature of the pee. But then they worked out why this was. So they all started using mercury and stuff like that in the development of hats. But the thing about it is, if you use mercury often enough or for long enough, it can start to play with your mind. And that was where you got Mad Hatters from.
Oh, right.
Huh. Oh, you didn't know
you
that.
You see?
Oh. No, I didn't know that at all.
You see?
Alice in Wonderland, the Mad Hatter.
So, Mad Hatter.
Oh, wow.
So, that's a fabulous looking badger. I wonder, did he pee on it? Right, so that's Chaska. Right, look, talk to me about Sheena.
We've got the big Sheena, the bear, who a lot of people are saying might be like the companion almost to Chaska. So we've got these two people fighting together on the pitch, effectively.
Totally see how that works. Do you know what? If you look at them, their clothes look the same.
They look very similar,
with the big stitches and stuff like that. I reckon Chaska and Sheena are compatriots. I think that they're very cool.
You're onto something here. They are the same, except one's a bear and one's a man.
I wonder is there any possibility of him being a shapeshifter? I don't think there is. I don't think he turns into Sheena because I don't see the badger hat anywhere.
I don't think so. No, but,
no bear would be caught in a badger hat. No way, never. I've got to say though, it's the Guild Ball stuff is totally on fire. It is.
It
totally
is. It really
on
is.
Fire.
They're doing amazing stuff with their range and building on it.
We are reaching out to the guys to try and get them on the show, so as we can get a bit of Guild Ball action going. I want to build a Guild Ball pitch. I'm going to set Lloyd a challenge for a Hobby Lab. To build a Guild Ball kind of stadium type thing.
Is a Guild Ball pitch rectangular in shape?
No. Well, yes. Well, it can be rectangular or square. You know, is it 3x3x2 or something like that?
Yeah, I don't think it's very big, and it's meant to represent the fact that they could just play it anywhere. I think so. Yeah.
What else is on that pitch?
What else is on there?
Yeah, so as well as that, as the models, they're also working on some themed dice for the Hunter's Guild, so you can pick those up. They look pretty swish if you want to sort of personalize things. And also, we've talked about it before, but Battle Foam do some really cool Guild Ball bags. So if you've just picked up the Hunter's Guild and you want to keep them all safe, go and pick up some Battle Foam. There's some fantastic stuff that they do for that, where you can keep everything in one place, including your tokens and your models. Yeah.
Well, on the topic of Battle Foam, Battle Foam also, with the announcement of Warhammer Quest I keep forgetting the name of this.
Silver Tower.
Warhammer Quest Silver Tower. On the topic of that, do you remember back when Space Hulk first came out?
Yes.
And Battlefoam created these great pieces of foam that actually fitted inside the box?
It was really handy, actually.
Yeah, well, they have done it again. And they've done it for Silver Tower. So you can get it that it'll fit in a bag, but I'm also told that these will fit quite happily inside the retail box that it comes in.
So they have two, well, a couple of different variations in which you can pick up. You can obviously pick it up with the bag itself, which is one of the pack 216 bags, and it comes with the foam trays that allow you to have all the models from Silver Tower, plus the ones that are coming out as additional heroes through the app and things like that. They also sell the trays separately as well, and the last option is the one that Warren's referring to here, where you can buy the towers, the Silver Tower trays, which fit right into the box.
So if you scroll to the top, these are the ones for the bags, right? And then the last picture we're looking at is the one that specifically fits the box, is it?
Yes, and that one's just for the models. You put all the tiles and the tokens underneath, and then you sit the box top back on there. So
Okay. Yeah. So and then on the topic. We see all our segues through here. So on the topic of Silver, Silver Tower, that leads us very nicely to Blood Bowl, believe it or not. So on Blood Bowl, we're starting to see the actual contents of the box now, Ben.
Yeah, so they finally revealed exactly what's going to be in the sort of the starter box that you get for the game. So it'll come with the human and orc teams that are in the colored plastics that we talked about last week. You also get some really interesting things in terms of the way that the stat cards are done.
Yeah.
They know that people don't want to be hunting around in books straight away when they play the game, so they've developed sort of stat cards. They allow you to play with like your throwers and your linesmen straight away and just see them all arrayed in front of you. So you'll have all the basic stats for your players and some of the star players straight away to get going quickly with the game, if you know what you're doing with Blood Bowl, of course.
Yeah.
I take it, Ben, you were at an event. You've seen some of this up close. We have pictures and stuff.
Yeah, so there's some really nice glossy stuff that they've been showing off at Warhammer Fest and things like that. So they showed off some of the painted teams, which we've got some pictures of, and also a little close-up of what the rule book and all the other bits and pieces are going to look like. The dice especially are looking really nice. They've gone out of their way to do some fantastic nice designs on the block dice and stuff, as well as the normal D6. They look good. And there's also another dice they've put in there for the random direction of ball movement and stuff like that, because it was really hard rolling a D6 and trying to work out that, so they put a D8 in there as well. The other really cool thing about the Blood Bowl set is that the pitch itself and the dugouts are reversible, so they'll have humans on one side and orcs on the other.
Oh
no, that's a nice touch.
The other really cool thing is that when it came to developing the boards, what they did is they actually went out and built themselves an actual Blood Bowl pitch out of hobby materials, then took a top-down picture of the pitch, and that's what they've used for the board. So it's exactly like how they developed it for sort of like practical purposes and stuff. So
That's cool. Can you remind me, Ben, is this a plastic set and who's releasing it? Is Games Workshops themselves releasing this? Because there was talk about Forge World taking over the Blood Bowl type stuff.
Yeah.
Where does it land? Where is it at the minute?
At the moment, it's a cross between Games Workshop and Forge World developing this starter set, where the first stuff you get will be plastic. And then I'm fairly sure that everything after that is going to be stuff through Forge World. So yeah, you'll be able to expand with new teams and things like that, but they'll be in resin from Forge World and stuff, so...
Awesome stuff. Again, another board game coming out of GW.
Yeah, exactly.
Lots of quick fire stuff coming from them now. You know, it's every point over the last 6 years, we've thought, oh, we're being spoiled. Surely it's going to slow down. It's not slowing down. You know, right across the industry, there's just amazing stuff coming out, and in this case, coming back out.
Yeah.
Right. I have an interesting one for you. It's a new company set up called Mitosis Miniatures.
Okay. Yep.
Okay. Who are going to be releasing a range of miniatures, but they're trying to do something slightly different. So let me show you what we've got here. So this is the Goblin Rat Rider. Okay.
Now, that's cool.
Yep. You can go ahead and buy these miniatures and just buy into them, and there's lots of nice options or whatever. But one of the things that they're doing is they're kind of giving you the option to purchase licenses,
right,
to recast the miniatures yourself. So you could buy a personal license, which allows you to make molds of the components, right, and cast as many different variations of it as you want, because it has a range of head options and different options and stuff like that, so they don't have to look the same.
Yeah.
So you can buy that, you know, as a personal license, which allows you to freely make your molds and recast it for your own personal army.
So if I'm buying it, I can buy the miniature.
Yep.
Or I can buy the mold.
No, you can buy the miniature.
Yeah.
Or you can, I believe you buy the miniature with the personal license. Okay. I'm coming to the mold bit in a second.
Do I make my own mold then? Or
yes. So
if
that,
you,
you can make your own mold, right?
Because I have the license to say because I can make as many of these as I want for myself.
The next one they have is the commercial license.
Okay.
Okay. Where you can buy the master. Okay. So by buying that, you get a master that you can make a mold from.
Yeah.
Okay. And then you can recast for commercial purposes and resell them on to your mates or to whoever.
Okay.
Now, at the moment, I don't believe that they're actually selling the molds, but that well could change, and where you actually just buy the molds themselves. I'm really, really interested to see how Mitosis get on with this.
So let me see if I have this straight. So Mitosis is more of a, they create the IP, but don't worry too much about the manufacturing of it.
Yes, yeah, so they're creating the IP, and
in a way, I
believe that basically what they're trying to do is to say, well, look, you know, if you want to recast this, you're just buying the one thing, and you can recast it and create you know, as many of them as you want for your armies and things like that. Mm. Why I'm interested in this specifically, if you bring it up, there's a piece of artwork of the goblin on the rat there. But I think that this is really interesting because I, as you know, like yourself, have been a huge fan of Bruce Hurst over the years and the Hurst Art molds.
Yes.
Okay. I think that the Hurst Art molds were one of the finest products I have ever seen.
They were really good because you could buy them in and immediately feel you were really good at doing something.
Yes. Yeah. Hurst Art molds were the original kind of castle molds, and they were RTV rubber molds that you poured dental plaster in, or resin if you had access to resin, and you were able to create lots of little blocks, and it was like a big beautiful Lego kit. And you used a tacky glue, and you put all the blocks together, and you made your castles and your dungeons and whatever else.
And then you sat back and went, I'm flipping amazing!
I am amazing. Look what I have done. Right. We are now getting to the stage where, with 3D printing and 3D design, that a lot of these guys are now seeing the potential where, hey, you know, instead of selling you the miniature, why don't we just sell you the mold, you know? And it's
so look at it going, we'll do the creative element,
yeah,
and you do the fulfillment element for yourself.
Yeah and I'm really interested in it. Like, I'm looking at this thinking, you know, I personally don't have a use for a goblin on a rat just yet. If it had been on a giant cock, I could have used it in the Ridend. But it's not. It's on a rat, and as far as I know, rats and cocks don't get along. So, you know, he's not no use in my army. However, if that were something that I was interested in, I've got to say I would be very, very tempted to go in and to buy a mold of that, especially if it was configurable.
Yeah.
And I would just cast the hell out of it and just build myself just a huge, raging force.
Yeah, especially if you could get the mold of the red end cock.
Yes.
Because then you could just cast loads of red end cocks.
Mm-hmm. And it would be fabulous.
Would be pretty cool.
However,
after
the break, I want to take this a step further.
Okay.
Because this is about buying the mold. This is about empowering us as hobbyists to say, well, actually, we can start to recreate and build up our stuff ourselves. Okay. But after the break, we've been joined by Matt from Printable Scenery, okay,
yep,
to talk about their latest Kickstarter, which takes this to the very next level, okay, where you're buying digital files and printing them out on your home computer.
Which is awesome, because they've had a couple of successful Kickstarters and stuff like that, and I was looking at them It's been the one thing is looking at what they're doing with terrain that's been going, I need to buy a 3D printer.
Yes.
I need to buy a 3D printer. And now they're back again. And like you say, we have a class interview with Matt Barker. Should we just get on with it?
Let's jump into it after we tell you about some hubs.
Anime cyberpunk style meets skirmish combat in Infinity. Experience 8 high-tech factions and fight to control the human sphere at the Infinity Hub on beastofwar.com. Become a general of mighty armies at the Kings of War Hub. Take command of elves, dwarves, and orcs in this game of masked fantasy combat on beastofwar.com.
Okay, guys, I'm here with Warren and Matt Barker from PrintableScenery.com, and I'm kind of excited to talk about this because I love terrain. I love making terrain and stuff, and I love this idea of being able to 3D print terrain.
Yeah.
Matt and his fellow colleagues run a website, PrintableScenery.com, and you can download 3D printed or 3D files to print on your printers to create cool fantasy buildings and stuff like that. Matt, great to have you on the show. You've done a successful Kickstarter. Now you're back on Kickstarter to do another Kickstarter. Can you describe what the Kickstarters are for?
Well, essentially, from our last Kickstarter, we had a lot of people asking us for ruins and ruined buildings. That was probably 50% of the requests. So we decided two things. We decided, one, let's make ruins, but then also let's expand the selection of what we're doing out to other theatres of war. So instead of just doing fantasy, because the last two Kickstarters were just fantasy models, to move more into historical World War II and to incorporate some more RPG, Frostgrave style stone ruins,
yep.
And then to move into the sci-fi kind of gothic sci-fi kind of look as well.
Okay, with the original two Kickstarters you've done, I thought it was one, but it's two, that's even better. So you're telling me...
We did one Kickstarter and then an Indiegogo, sorry.
All right, so the Indiegogo followed on from the Kickstarter. Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
They were all fantasy-based, and you could build, what could you build? Like a village with castle walls and things like that?
Well, yeah, you can build... our last models, the very last stretch goals we just released from the Indiegogo, and that's the whole... You can build an entire city, basically.
Yeah.
We've even got little road sections, which are part of the Barbican. It's all scalable and interchangeable. There's a massive amount of stuff you can build from cottages, the observatory. A lot.
Okay, and the new Kickstarter then. So as you scroll down the page, like you say, you see fantasy, pulp punk horror, weird sort of buildings, sci-fi buildings. You design them with a modular sense that you can really push them all together and make a one big modular table rather than... I know the last Kickstarter had buildings and stuff that went together like castle walls in a modular system, but this, just browsing down the page, it looks like you can push it all really dense together and make a really epic multi-layered sort of layout to play on. I think that's the case.
Yeah, so everything's based on the 50mm or the 2-inch by 2-inch dungeon tile, if you like. And a lot of scenery is already like that, so it's compatible with everything, a lot of the other stuff that's out there, you know, the mass-produced stuff. And so the idea with the modular ruins is you can select what you want and then print those components and build those components. If you're doing something like a mass production run, you can only really make, say, 10 or 20 components that are, you know, and then you have to mass produce those because you have to pay for the cost of the dies and everything. But with this, you can have like 100 or 200 different components, and you can just pick the pieces you want.
Yeah.
And you can print those pieces, and then you might be looking at it and say, oh, I'd like a piece with a double window there. So you go and find that, print that piece, and pop that piece in there. So the modularity allows you to kind of mix and match it all up.
With this being something you 3D print at home, modularity works really well because, like Matt says, you literally just go, oh, I need another one of those.
Matt, one of the questions that I have is, like, we are absolutely fascinated by 3D printing here in Beast of War. And over the course of even the last 2 years, we've steadily been watching it, looking at it from when is the right time to kind of to jump into it. Now we're seeing 3D printers... retailing around £200 or £300, maybe $400 or $500, and they're getting to that stage where you're thinking, that actually looks affordable. but it's still not affordable enough yet to shell out $500 if the machine is crap. Are we at that stage where buying your files that that the right $500-$600 machine will give us a decent end product from the files that you're delivering that we can then stick on our gaming tables and have a blast with?
Well, I mean, everything that we've printed out here and now, where we test it all, is all printed either on a Prusa i3, which is like a $500 printer, and the duplicator, which is sitting over there, the Wanhao duplicator. And I think they're like $500 US or $499 or something like that. So we kind of test it. We're not using, we do have a MakerBot that we used to use, 3 years ago when we first started this. But now we're using these cheaper printers that are just as good as the old MakerBot. We test on that and we print on that. And everywhere we take the models, people say, wow, they're fantastic. So I think now it's at the stage where you can put something on a table and people say, and you tell them it's 3D printed and they go, no way. I mean, if I throw the tavern, I throw that down on a table, anywhere,
yeah,
and I tell people it's 3D printed, they pick it up and say, you're kidding.
And is that printed on one of the affordable machines then? Showing us there? No, obviously
yeah,
via
that's printed on the i3, yeah. On the Prusa i3.
Obviously via Skype and video, it's not so easy to see it, but we will get some photographs of that so we can have a look at it.
One of the questions is, if we're talking about different levels of machine, is do you take into account when you're designing stuff what the print will be like? Do you know the way, at this point in time, people at home are not going to buy 3D printers to print miniatures, but I think terrain is a perfect application.
Terrain is really there now, it's... I take it that you guys are now at the stage where even in your design, as Lloyd says, you're kind of taking in the capabilities of what home printers and things have and understanding some of the nuances of it so that we don't have to.
Yeah, that's right. I mean, you take, for example, the roof sections on this print here. I know you might not be able to see that very well, but the slope of that roof is easily within the tolerances of a 3D printer to print that angle.
Yeah.
And then when you look at this edge here, the 3D printer can print that edge quite well, and you can see some of that. There's a little bit of stringing there that bits hang off, but you just clean those off and break them up.
Yeah.
If I get a fence, this is a little fence section. Now the 3D printer, the 3D printer prints that no problem.
Yep.
And it prints those spans and those overhangs because the gap is within the minimum limits for the printer head to move across and lay the filament down over an open cavity. So we try to keep all of those parameters that are capable of the average $500 home printer.
I've seen videos online where people take stuff that's been 3D printed and they put it in acetone and things like that to take sort of patterns and stuff off. Do people at home need to worry about that? Or can they literally just print the stuff, paint it, dry brush it, whatever way they want to do it, and go, that looks awesome. Do we need to worry about acetone washes or anything strange or wonderful?
Everything on that Kickstarter, all of those photos and all the images currently on our Facebook page, none of that's had any treatment. We used to wash everything, but I think we just got kind of over it. Mm-hmm. And you do see the very slight resolution, very slight lines going through. And if you want to get rid of that, you can wash it in acetone if it's ABS plastic. If it's PLA plastic, you have to wash it in chloroform, and you'll need to buy that from the chemist because those two solvents dissolve ABS plastic and chloroform.
Yeah. Yeah.
If it bugs you, you kind of can give it a wash in that. But
if we just browse your gallery of stuff and look at it and go, oh, that looks awesome, we'll be happy if we buy a 3D printer and buy your files, because we should get files that look like your stuff, because you're saying you're not washing them and stuff anymore. You're just printing them out and saying, there you go, that's what it looks like. Happy.
Bar any errors, because machines can and do go wrong. We have heard of the guys who have spent 6 hours waiting for a print only for it to turn out not great. But talking about time, okay, on the subject of time, you know, how long does a typical print on a typical machine now take? You know, is it a case of waiting 18 and a half hours for a couple of bricks, or is it a bit faster now?
Okay, so say going back to this broken level of the French farmhouse, I think that takes about 2.5 hours to print that one level. So you end up at the end of the day, you just set the printer going and leave it,
yep,
and then come back and change it. So by the end of the day, you have one farmhouse. So when you first see the printer printing, you know, and you think, you look at it and you say, geez, that's going to take forever to make that. The first day you end up with a farmhouse. The second day you've got two farmhouses.
Yeah.
Within a week, you've got a table full of this amazing scenery. And you're like, what else can I print?
So it's not instantaneous, but the plus side is waiting a day for something is quicker than waiting for it to be posted.
And it's less messy than mucking around with resins and things like that.
And if you try to, like you're saying, if you try to build it yourself, you'd spend a lot more than 2 hours trying to build that one platform part.
Now, the other thing that I have found is that people have sent us very kindly samples of 3D printed buildings with the ABS plastic or the other plastic alternative. And I've got to say, they are incredibly robust. Like, I mean, really robust. You know, it's... we've been mucking around, knocking them over.
One of the plus sides.
And I've found them to be, in many ways, even more solid than the equivalent resin building.
That is one of the plus sides, because you can clip the side of a resin building moving around by mistake and a bit will fly off.
Mm.
The plastic buildings are just plastic.
Anything that we have seen so far, they just seem to be really, really solid. Let's talk a little bit about costs of printing, Matt. One of the things that I've heard, and Herigold on the site, who's one of our kind of resident 3D printing guys, who's just really, really into it. One of the overriding benefits that he keeps coming back to us on is the actual material costs are really, really cheap, comparatively speaking, to the buildings that you get, especially whenever you're using the likes of the plastic spools and things. I know that on some of the DLP, I think they're the 3D DLP printers where they're shining light through resins and things like that. I know the resins can start to get more expensive, but they're very high-resolution machines, probably more suited to actually printing miniatures. But for terrain, what's the final print cost looking like on some of those?
You're looking, I guess, about... to print that little Flames of War house would be sort of $2 or $3.
Now, that house you're holding up is the same as the one we've just looked at 28mm scale, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's the same. It's just scaled up by... just scaled down, sorry. And that one, you're more looking at about $5-6.
Yeah.
I mean, the thing is, when we first started, we made the walls quite thick because we were used to the resin buildings, you know, like even our dungeon tiles, the first ones we made were not fat dungeon tiles, just like a resin dungeon tile.
Yeah.
And it needs the strength, and you think you have to do that. But you quickly realize that, one, that's a waste of plastic, and two, it looks much better if you make it thin and kind of realistic, you know, and you can make these small little pieces of detail that are strong and hold, and they, you know, I've got this like dungeon door somewhere here. So that's a dungeon door tile we've made. And that prints just like that. I mean, it's really strong. It uses hardly any plastic. That costs about 50 cents to print.
Yeah.
And it prints out just like that with no cleanup, and then you just, because there's tiny little supports on the bottom, you just push the doors and they, you know, they're opening and closing. And that's all, that comes just like that, and you simply just paint it. And that hasn't been treated either.
That's awesome.
So one of the other benefits of all of this is for those of us, like, you know, we're about to, in September time, all been well, embark on a historical global campaign, right? And it's all multi-system and stuff like that. And many of us are into a couple of different scales of system, especially in the historical side, which I now consider myself an honorary member of, right? We like our 15 mil games and we like our 28 mil games because it gives us different experiences. And yes, some of you like to go down to 6 mil and beyond. This, Lloyd, gives us the opportunity to buy the STL files. And then if we want to, you just rescale them. For that 15 mil building, Matt, you know, that's just downscale it by 60% and let the printer do the work, yeah?
Yeah, so Flames of War, because we're obviously we're designing these specifically for war games, that's your bolt action size, and then you go down by 0.6, and that's your Flames of War size, and you're getting two bases fitting in there perfectly. So yeah, you just
I take it there is a limit to how far you can scale it down before details and things don't work anymore.
That's right. Yeah. So the all of ours are tested to 50% scale. Some of the models we actually in our fantasy collection we made them as solid blocks because there's some guys asking for a few of the models to be made for Warmaster and they wanted these 6 mil kind of little tiny models. So we just went through and asked them which ones they wanted specifically for some club in America, and we just converted those into solid blocks and scaled them right down and put them as options. Mm-hmm. So when people buy from us and they ring us up or they email us and tell us that's what they need, we'll make these little conversions for them because other people might use them as well, you know.
Yeah.
Cool, Matt. Can we just go touch back on the actual Kickstarter and what you're raising funds for at the minute and what people can expect at the end of it and how long you think it'll take.
So Matt, we're seeing the stone ruins, if you want to bring that up on screen. So we're seeing the stone ruins, they look absolutely lovely. And then we have the World War II stuff, which whenever you actually get a chance to look at the detail of it, those walls are beautiful, absolutely beautiful. We have all the gothic sci-fi stuff, you know, any sci-fi player of 40K or whatever is going to be looking at that going, oh, I could do a lot with that. But then a bit further on down, we see the frigates.
That's cool.
Matt, tell us a bit about it.
Yeah, the frigate. And we're going to make a ruined version of that as well, I reckon. But the frigate came because a lot of us bought into the pirate Kickstarter that was on recently.
Blood and Plunder, yes. Yeah.
So as soon as we bought into that, we're like, oh, we've got to make a ship because there's no way you can buy a decent looking ship on the internet, really. Not a ready-made one. There's quite a few out there. So we just thought we'd go for it and make a ship, mainly because we wanted that.
Yeah.
And everyone we showed it to has been like, yes.
So some of the stretch goals that we're seeing is we're seeing things like French historic houses, the demon dais, Roman ruins, the abbey. Like, there is a ton there that the potential backers, hopefully, if they get together, can kind of unlock.
Aztec ruins is cool.
Yeah.
Why that's cool is because one of the things with 3D printing is you guys can design up scenery files that traditionally wouldn't be that popular.
Yeah.
So much as to do a run of a proper full-on production
for.
This really opens the possibility of getting more niche products and stuff in there.
Yeah.
I know you'll still want to sell a lot of them, but I'm saying you don't need to sell as many of them to make it happen.
Yeah.
Which is cool.
Yeah, I mean, we basically went through I think it's about 3 years we've been kind of since we first started. But in that time, we've kind of amassed together a list on our forum and stuff and emails of the different things that people wanted. So we kind of put it all up on the wall. And we went through it and tried to work out what would be most useful and most compatible with different systems so that we weren't making a specialized thing for one guy, you know. And, yeah, we came up with those. So it was kind of a mixture of comments from a lot of our really keen printing customers that buy all our stuff and the team just getting awesome. Together and working out what was best.
Awesome stuff. So anybody who's interested then can hop on to Kickstarter right now. It's running. And search for the Apocalypse Ruins from Printable Scenery.
Yeah.
And they'll come across this awesome Kickstarter.
Matt, thank you so much for joining us. It's been absolutely fascinating. Guys, head on over and check it out. And do post below your thoughts on 3D printing, specifically for terrain. Terrain is the thing that we're interested in.
In a world controlled by massive corporations, a steady aim and split-second decisions are needed for your Megacom to complete its goals. Begin your missions at the Mercs Hub on beastofwar.com. Enter into the dangerous dungeons of Myth as a mighty hero and stand against the darkness. Visit the Myth Hub on beastofwar.com and begin your story.
So the world of 3D printing gets much, much closer again.
Awesome stuff. They literally just launched that Kickstarter when we come in and do the interview with them.
Mm-hmm.
But I have no doubt it'll fund. The first two were funded, no problem.
Yeah.
I'm sure this one will go... Or not first two, the first one, and then they need to go top up or whatever they were doing.
But it is interesting, you know, because it's like we were talking before the interview about, you know, the giving people the capacity to make their own stuff, you know, with these licenses and things like that. But 3D printing is the logical conclusion. It is where we're headed. You know, we're bound to be getting to the stage now where terrain is just viable on a 3D printer, maybe costing $500. You know, it is a step towards it. Now, for the longest time, you know, there has been kind of a bit of pushback saying, oh, well, you know, 3D printing miniatures is still a long way off. I'm not so sure, Lloyd. You know, I remember when the inkjet printers came out, you know, when we moved from our dot matrix to our first inkjet printers. Do you remember the huge developments in resolution on inkjet printing? You know, it was phenomenal.
It's radically different.
Yeah.
What I'm wondering about is that, like, on terrain, for example, at the minute, a lot of us make our own terrain.
Mm.
Will making terrain become more of a dying art in favor of just buying the file and printing terrain?
Maybe.
I don't know.
Interesting to see.
I don't think so. There'll always be people out there who just want, like yourself, to grab whatever cheap-ass household goods and things you can gather up and make interesting.
There's something that a lot of people don't seem to understand. So a lot of people get it, but a lot of people don't, is that terrain making is a hobby in itself.
Yeah.
Some people look at terrain as just a means to play into the game. A lot of other people like myself look at terrain and go, no, that's a good 90% of the hobby for me. It's just making the cool terrain.
And that's an important thing to be able to take on board yourself. Like tomorrow, in tomorrow's XLBS, we're going to be talking about the healthy hobby.
Yeah.
Okay. And a healthy approach to your hobby, and in taking joy in your hobby, and understanding that the hobby is different things to different people, but it's still equally the hobby. But here are my big developments, okay, of what's coming up. Ben, I reckon we will see the resolution increase to the point where we'll have no problem printing miniatures at all.
Probably.
I think we will see material advances where we will be able to print miniatures faster because a lot of that is down to curing time, not only the ability to move the head of the printer or whatever around, whatever method they use. Most importantly, I think what we will actually find is we will find that printers will have a material of some sort, like an ABS, maybe a plastic or something like that, but we will also have ink or what we'll call pigments, okay? And there'll be pigment cartridges just like your inkjet printer, okay, will be in there, and the print head will mix pigments with the print material at the time of printing.
There is a 3D.
And we will have full color miniatures, which ultimately will end up with Angel Geralde's level paint jobs.
There is a 3D printer that does that at the minute. But it doesn't use plastic.
Uses paper.
Yeah, it prints the color on the paper, and then they actually have a printed and textured painted miniature.
Yep.
I'm wondering what it's going to do. Will it create the those who can do it and those who can't do it scenario?
That's one of those sideshow technologies. That's it's the DVD in the 3D printing market. In other words, it's useful for somebody who needs that now, but that's not the future. The future of this will be some form of a polymer, a plastic polymer, with pigment inkjet cartridges.
We're in agreement that we're not just going to have high resolution.
No, we're going to have high resolution
stuff
full
that you can
color.
Literally go.
Yeah.
That's the scheme I want print.
Mm-hmm.
That's the scheme I want print.
And the reason we're going to have all of this is because and the reason I'm so confident that 3D printing will grow at this fast rate is because it's not only useful for our hobby. We are a tiny percentage of the potential of what 3D printing will actually allow once it gets there. You know, this is our first step towards replicators.
It'll be a different hobby as well, though. There'll be very defined lines between those who like to build stuff and paint and those who just want a game, because somebody who just wants the game can go, I want this model, I want that head, I want this color scheme, print 2-3 hours later, playing. Whereas somebody who still wants to paint, print the model and say, I want this head and that now, but I don't want any painting because I want to do that artistic part myself.
Yes. Yeah. It's kind of interesting and scary at the same time, where we find ourselves as human beings at this point, right? Because we sent a man to the moon 50 years ago?
Something like that. Yeah, a long time ago.
And then we had 50 odd years of development, but not development as quick as what we were expecting it, because we were expecting flying cars by this stage. We were expecting all sorts of weird and wonderful sci-fi things. Like, I remember as a child thinking that I would be going in rockets by the year 2000. You know, the year 2000 was suddenly this marker of, oh, when we get to the year 2000, it's going to be like a sci-fi world. I think we are actually now reaching the point in our lifetime where development is, I think by the time we reach our 80s, that we will probably not recognize this world. We will have viable self-driving cars. We will have buildings that will be printed. You know, buildings will be printed out, and the materials will be super strong. There'll be no need for steel and stuff like that. They'll be printed.
Absolutely, because you think of skyscrapers, they'll just fly in a printer, put it down, and the printer will rise along with the
sky. Yeah, it will just rise, yeah.
Take it away, build another one somewhere else.
But, you know, we're also looking at a massive change in how that things are made.
Are we all going to become really lazy and do nothing?
Well, that depends. Either that or we're all going to die. Because two things are going to happen.
Happy Saturday.
One is the way product is delivered is going to change, okay? You know, these 3D printers and things, you know, this manufacturing in your own home is going to be a thing, okay? Yeah. You know, sooner or later, we will perfect nanotechnology, and then it's all bets off when we get to that stage. There's a conversation from a few years back. But before I get to that, the other thing is robotics, okay? We see now that Foxconn have replaced 60,000 workers with robots in China, okay? Now, if in China it's more cost-effective to replace people with robots, what hope do the rest of us have, okay? With the advancements in machine learning and the advancements in robotics, we are very soon not going to be having trouble to seek a job. There will not be a job. And our only hope will be for some kind of universal basic income or something like that. The world will have to change. Economics will have to change. We will have to just be, they'll have to just drop money out of helicopters, is the way the economists put it. Because there just won't be work. We will have reached a level of production efficiency where it just is nothing for human beings to do. So we will have to look for hobbies and things like this.
And because we have no drive to do things, we'll just fizzle out as a species.
Well, maybe, or maybe not, or maybe
there is a theory that if we have no drive to do things, that we
human beings will always have a drive to do something. We will have the drive to explore. We will have the drive to search out new places in the universe. The difficulty is if the 1% decide not to give us the capacity to do that. If they decide, well, actually, we're not going to give a kind of a universal basic income, but we're not going to give you everything that you need for free because there is nothing for you to do other than to explore and stuff, then we're in real shtuck, okay? But that's a political thing. It'll pan itself out. But my key point is this is all edging towards nanotechnology, the most, probably the least talked about of all the technologies that we have at the moment, but the most important for us as a species. because if we can reach a stage where we have a viable replication using nanotechnology, then we can build anything we want from the very dirt in the ground. You know, there is nothing that we couldn't manufacture just from the very dirt in the ground, and then suddenly anything that we need is there. That's replicators. That's when we reach Star Trek. And that, honestly, is when some grandchild of mine will be Jean-Luc Pivoirzan on the starship Warzan, starship Beast of War, in honor of us predicting it. And he'll be out flying around Uranus. So...
Yeah. There'll only be entertainers in the future.
There will only be entertainers in the future. Yeah. So,
Ben.
So 3D printing, an important first step.
Yeah, I was going to say, Ben, printing manager is cool, huh?
Yeah, at that level, fantastic. Now
right.
Technology's the next step. Yeah.
We want to close out by having a look at a couple of Kickstarters, right?
Yeah,
now, absolutely. I know some of you guys don't like Kickstarters, but please have a look at the very least of this first one, okay? Because this one has. This one has a soft spot in my heart. Okay.
Yeah.
There's a guy out there, a little guy. I love him a lot, and he goes under the moniker of Andy2D6, and
This is his YouTube name,
yeah,
or something. Yeah.
And he runs a YouTube channel under Andy2D6, and I've adored him for a long time. He just makes me laugh. Okay. He has done skits. He does little skits and things. He's in the wargaming community, and he does these little skits. Andy, no harm to you, son, but you're as odd as can be, but I love you. And he's done impersonations of Daryl and myself. He does this horrific impersonation of Joey Berry. Joey, how are you? And I've just enjoyed watching him over the years. But Andy has created a game. It's a card game. It's a little family card game about hamsters storing nuts in their cheeks. And the game is called Cheekz. And Andy contacted us and asked me, would I help spread his cheeks?
Oh.
So, me and Andy are on the same wavelength, boys. So it's, and girls. I've got a picture of it here, okay? So here we have it.
Yeah.
He is funded already, but don't let that stop you going over and backing this man, because he is hilarious. It's a great little game, okay? You have sunflower seed cards that you're trying to store. You have your defense cards and you have your attack cards. And you and your buddies are trying to build up these kind of combos of attack and defense. And then ultimately it all kind of pans out. You know, it's just cute. It's just cute. And he has some great fun little moments in it, you know, where... You know, whenever the round is finished, all the losers have to spread their cheeks. Just love it. Just love it. Just love it. And then, you know, there's dirty cheeks.
Right.
And, you know, if you spread, I don't think you have to spread your dirty cheeks. I just think you spread your cheeks, and then one of them cheeks might be dirty of the two spread. Ugh, never worry. But
What is the game? Is it a battle game?
It's about hamsters. It's about, well, you see, bring it up, right? It's about Willie the Waiter.
It's effectively...
Lana, the scientist, Beatrice the burglar, and Percy the pirate. And Percy the pirate loves to get loot and stick it in his cheeks. It's just great. It is just great. Ben, give us a more in-depth view of it.
Okay, so effectively, it works in the same way, almost like as a push your luck or sort of try your luck style, a little bit in the way that you'd view something like poker. Effectively, what will happen is someone around the table who's playing as one of these characters, one of these hamsters, will play down a specific battle card, and that could have a +4, or it could be a big punch, a small punch, a weak, whatever. And then everyone else can decide to join in this fight. From there, you play the cards in your hand that you've mentioned with the pluses and the minuses to defense and things like that into other people's hands or in your own. And at the end, you reveal and whoever's the winner will be the person who allows all the other players to spread their cheeks, and you take cards and they lose cards from their hand. The other aspect to this, which is quite interesting, is that you can choose to stay out of those bouts and stay out of those fights. But then at that point, you can't stash your seeds once you've done that to get to the magic number of 8. So it's all about working out whether or not you're going to win in a particular fight, or whether or not you should sit this one out and then potentially take another shot in the next one and things like that. Yeah. And there's some sort of quirky bits and pieces in there, as you said.
There's a baby girl, dude. Oh, yeah. Come on. It's got a tiny little hamster with a hammer. How cute is that?
Visually, these are cute looking cards here.
Yeah.
It's cute sort of visualizing all these hamsters run up kicking 10 shades of nuts out of each other.
Yes. Yes. It is...
But it's like
it is what it is. Go and check it out.
But it's like poker in so much as you build a hand, don't you?
Effectively, it's probably a bit more like keep it secured in that way. But it's a very light, very, very simple game. It's not as bluffing as you would imagine like poker and stuff is, but it does have an element of it that's like that, yeah.
And come on, right? How many of us are going to love the moment when you're sitting there with all your friends playing it for the first time and you get to turn around and say, okay, everybody, it's now time to spread your cheeks.
Well, if you're interested in it, hop on over there. Andy has some videos on how to play and stuff.
Yes, he does. He does.
The intro video was actually really cute too. Watch the intro video at the top.
Yeah. Well done, Andy, mate. Well done. Yeah, you made me smile with that one, so... Yeah.
Moving on, Ben, you've got one that you want to talk about. Faith, A Garden in Hell. Now, we've seen stuff from Faith before.
Yeah, so they came and did an interview with us, a written interview, quite a while back when they first did their original Kickstarter. It was all about building their sci-fi RPG.
Yeah.
But a lot of the community came back to them and said that they really wanted a way for people to get stuck into Faith and learn how to play with a sort of almost like a starter box. And so that's exactly what A Garden in Hell is looking to do. The Kickstarter is looking to build their first sort of starter standalone campaign that you can play with your friends and get stuck straight into with pre-made characters and all the bits and pieces that you need in order to play the game. So, yeah. And there's some fantastic stuff in here. The artwork is just brilliant across the board for this one. Yeah.
Now, I believe there's miniatures and stuff coming for this as well, Ben.
Yeah, they are going to be developing some miniatures for the game. It starts off very much in the sense that everything is meant to be done mind's eye, effectively. Yeah. So you play it like a normal role-playing game, but you can use miniatures. And they have developed one which is called Skid, which we might be giving away tomorrow on the backstage show. So yeah, there you go.
Is it a might, or are we giving it away on the backstage show tomorrow?
I was trying to be coy, but we are giving away. So yes, you'll have to tune in.
I have a picture of that, Ben. Yeah. So if I go to here and then scroll down to the bottom.
Yes, that one. No, up. No, up. There, up. That artwork. Click the, no, that.
This one that here. One.
Click it's that. The render at the bottom of the screen.
So. It's the render, yeah?
Yeah.
Oh, it's the render.
Yeah. So that's here we go. So there we go. So let's...
Yeah, so this guy is called Skid, and he's one of the Corvo, which are like these hyper-expansionists that have effectively saved humanity and have brought them under their wing. And this guy, Skid, is one of the characters who just loves war and fighting and battle, but he really, really likes technology as well. And so he's gone to the degree of sort of cybernetically enhancing himself. And so you've got this really awesome looking cool alien creature guy that you can get for the game. Yeah.
Awesome. So if somebody's interested in winning that, be sure to tune into the XLBS tomorrow.
Yeah.
Let's go back to Faith a little bit, Ben. Do you know much about the gameplay and the mechanics and things like that?
Yeah. So the really interesting thing about Faith as a role-playing game in terms of mechanics is that it doesn't use dice. It's all based on cards. And it uses what effectively is their version of a poker deck. So it's like a normal deck of cards, but it has their own numbers and values and things on it. And some fantastic artwork as well, which is all personalized to individual players and their races and things. But what will happen when you do a test is that you have your basic skill, which might be, for example, 3. And then you have an attribute, which might be 2 or 3, 4, etc.
Yep.
And this determines how many cards you play down to the table at any one time. And so how it works out is that you'll work out who's got the lowest, and they'll play a card face down, and then the other player will play a card face down, and then you'll keep going until you think you're going to have the highest score at the very end. So it's almost got that push your luck and sort of element of Malifaux effectively to it. So it follows along from a lot of the mechanics that that game enjoys and has done incredibly well.
Yeah, but the actual universe in which it's based, you're on a mission to try and capture a big queen type thing, isn't it?
Yeah, so the actual standalone campaign will have you playing as these pre-made characters that are part of this really cool Spec Ops force that has been sent by the Coalition to this world, and your ship crash lands, and you've got to go and try and find the Ravager Queen and extract information from her that'll help you win the war against the creatures.
So it's a campaign for 2 to 5 players spread over 7 to 12 sessions. So you get quite a lot of gameplay out of one box.
Yeah.
There's a whole bunch of different things in here for you to get stuck into. And as I say, they do have the pre-made characters, but you can also, because they supply you with the 1.5 rules, you could make your own characters as well and get started with your own sort of interesting adventures and strange characters and things based on their really amazingly diverse and interesting races.
The characters and stuff, because there's a set of pre-made ones in there that give them the opportunity to create miniatures and stuff. Is there different pledge levels, or how do you get the miniatures? Is that part of it, or how does that work?
You can get the miniature from Skid at the guy Skid at pledging for a certain level, but they will start to add things potentially down the line as stretch goals and locks and things like that. So you might see them as add-ons.
Yeah.
At the moment, they're aiming towards the stretch goals for some additional adventure expansions, which effectively add a couple of hours onto the campaign. So they've got one called the Mad Scientist Tower and Gamma Camp and things like that. So they're really developing this box and this adventure to make it something that you can continually grow and expand upon. Yeah.
Now, the results and stuff, they have some sort of community thing going on where if you enter results and stuff, it affects the universe going forward. Isn't that correct?
Yeah, so their idea is that the narrative will be community-driven and everything that goes forward in terms of the story will follow on from what everybody around the world is playing. So what will happen is once you've finished your campaign, you can input into the forums and share your experiences with them, and they'll start to look at developing the next step of the story. Based on what you guys have been doing and the heroes that die and the villains that win and things like that, So
awesome, really stuff. Cool. If we just go back to the miniature, because I know a lot of you out there are really into the miniatures and stuff. I just want to have a quick look at it. If you're interested in the miniature, come on over to the XLBS show tomorrow. Get your comment in, because that's the show you can actually win this on. Do we have the multi-pose? Of it. It's a 32 millimeter scale. If anybody's interested in the. In the actual scale of it and stuff, and it's really funky looking. It's really good, isn't it?
Yeah, it's one of those things that I think people should really take a deeper look at when it comes to Faith, in that they've developed this fantastic range of artwork and amazingly well-developed alien races and things like that, and that's translating over really nicely into the 3D renders that they're using for the miniatures and stuff like that as well. So, you should really go and check out all the stuff that they've been doing, and I think we're going to see some really fantastic stuff from these guys in the future as they look to develop all the different races. It feels very much a little bit like in the same vein as the guys at Fragged Empire have been doing, where they've been doing some really fantastic personal sculpts for the pre-made characters and things that you could then take on and develop into your own characters further down the line.
Awesome stuff, Ben. Well,
that is your lot.
That is it. We are out of time. If you want more, you're going to have to watch the XLBS show tomorrow. So come on over, join backstage. There's a 7-day free trial. We'll put the link in the notes. You can even jump in on just using the free trial to get your chance to win the mini and be really sneaky.
Yeah.
See you guys tomorrow.
Okay, guys. See you tomorrow.
Fight for the Iron Kingdoms as a Warcaster. Take control of the mighty jacks, arcane devices, and dark sorceries to bring the fight to the War Machine Hub on beastofwar.com. Keep your blaster handy. The West is a dangerous place. Fight to survive as men turn to monsters and the dead rise on the Wild West Exodus Hub at beastofwar.com.